Welcome to the Holy Spirit class. This is lesson number 3. And we're just going to get right into these lessons. We've got a lot of ground to cover today. So in this lesson, we're going to be looking at three things that Jesus taught about the Holy Spirit. Now, I'll say up front, he taught more than three things. But in this lesson, we're going to talk about three things that Jesus taught concerning the Holy Spirit. And if Jesus taught them, how many of you know they're important? And if Jesus taught them, then it's something we should know. Amen? So we're going to look at these three things. Now, a lot of the teaching on the Holy Spirit, we'll do repetition because, how many of you know, you probably don't learn it the first time you hear it. And so it's not because I don't have other things to say. It's on purpose that we repeat things. And we want to say it in so many different ways that surely you'll grasp one of them. So today, let's open our Bibles to John chapter 3. You say, that's where we were last time. That's a good place to be. John chapter 3. And remember, as we teach this course, this is not only for your understanding, but to equip you to go out and minister to this to others. And let me tell you, and it's certainly not boasting on me, but we've seen this work all over the world. And we've seen a lot of lives affected by these teachings and putting these teachings into practice. So this is not just theory. This is the real thing. It really works. And been working for years. And will continue to work as you begin to minister it in your own life. John chapter 3. We won't take the time to read the entire text because we've already covered that. But the first 6 verses of John chapter 3 is the account of Nicodemus coming to Jesus and asking, what he needs to have happen in his life in order for him to be a part of the kingdom of God. And Jesus responded to him and said that you had to be born again. And we covered this in lesson 1. But once again, we need to emphasize the fact that this is the beginning. This is where everybody starts in their relationship to God, in their entrance into the kingdom of God is through the new birth. And so the first thing that we're going to see that Jesus taught about the ministry of the Holy Spirit was that, number one, it's going to produce an inward change. Now, this is that's a point you probably need to kind of put a star by or highlight, because there's a good chance you'll see this later on. The Spirit produces an inward change. And here's what Jesus is saying to Nicodemus. That if we're going to enter into the kingdom of heaven, we're going to have to be born again. Nicodemus responded, and this is what we established, that whatever Jesus said when he said it, the thing that Nicodemus heard was going to be a birth process. Because of his response when he said, how can a man when he's old enter a second time into his mother's womb? So I keep emphasizing that because it's sad to observe. But all you have to do is open your eyes and understand that a lot of religious teaching doesn't emphasize that there has to be a birth process in order to get into the kingdom of God. There are far too many professing to be Christians who have done nothing more than walk the aisle, repeat a prayer, put their name on a church roll, be baptized in water, take communion, etc., etc., etc. And it's sad because we've got a lot of people walking around in deception because they followed all of those steps that have been laid down for them. And yet when you encounter these people, you realize there's no change in their life. And what I emphasize strongly, and I think Jesus emphasized it strongly, there is a birth process in order to get into the kingdom of God. You can't join the family of God. You have to be birthed into the family of God. And a birthing process is not a secret process. It's not one that you grow into over a period of time, but it happens in an instant of time. You must be born again. Now, as we lay that foundation, we know that in the beginning when God created man, he created him like himself and created him as a three-part being. Spirit, soul, and body. And commanded Adam and Eve after the creation that they could partake freely of everything that he'd provided except the one tree, not to eat of that tree, and in the day they ate, they would die. But just going back and reading the account, you know that the day they ate of that tree, they didn't fall over dead physically. I believe you can see that. They lived several hundred years after that. Their soulish realm didn't die because they were still able to communicate, not only with one another, but with God. So what part of man experienced death? And we have to ask that question if we believe God meant what he said when he said, "In the day that you eat thereof, you shall surely die." Matter of fact, if you go back and get you a good concordance and look up that terminology, you'll find out that actually what's being communicated, it says in the day that you eat thereof, in dying you shall die. So what he's saying is a death process started, but it started with the removal or the separation of God's spirit from man's spirit. God's spirit was in man. He breathed it into him. You can read that in the act of creation. So when God's spirit was taken out of man, man didn't cease to exist. Man's spirit didn't cease to exist, but now man's spirit was separated from God's spirit. And as prior to that, God could communicate spirit to spirit with Adam and Eve, now he was left to communicate only in their soul and flesh realm. And throughout all of the Old Testament, this is the way God communicated with his people. That's the reason all of the requirements were put down. All of the physical acts that were involved in approaching God, it had to be in that form because they couldn't respond to God spirit to spirit. And yet that was God's plan for man. And just because Adam and Eve messed up, you'll never find anywhere in there that God said, "But I've changed my plan for man." His plan remained the same. And through the process of time, and when it was due time, the Bible says that God sent forth his son, born of a virgin, who came into the world born of the Spirit. Came into the world born of the Spirit. And this was Jesus. And Jesus demonstrated in his earthly ministry exactly how God intended man to live from the very beginning. In a spirit-to-spirit communication. Being led by the Spirit. Being taught by the Spirit. Having things revealed by the Spirit. And when Jesus came, he said, "Now we're entering into a new phase. And you're going to be able to experience something that no one has been able to experience. From the beginning of time, you're going to be able to enter into a relationship with God that once again will be spirit to spirit. But in order to experience that, you have to have something born in you, which is once again your new spirit. Your spirit has to be born again or come alive again When God's Spirit and your spirit reunite, then spiritual life takes place. Why is this important? Because the spirit of each one of us is the real us. And the spirit in us is an eternal spirit. Just as God is a spirit who had no beginning, has no end, our spirit is made like God and it will have no end. Now that's good news for those of us that know Jesus. That's bad news for those who don't, because they're still going to be alive through all of eternity. But it's not going to be a real pleasant existence. But see, our spirit is eternal, and so what we needed to happen to us is that our spirit be born again back to its original plan of God, to be in the image and likeness of God. And Jesus says, as you're born again, there's an inward change that takes place. Paul the Apostle had the revelation and wrote to us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17 and says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature creation. The old is past. Behold, all is becoming new. And all of these new things that we're becoming are of God. So we need to understand that in this birthing process, we're talking about the spirit of man. When you accepted Jesus, if you were 6 foot tall, you'd be 6 foot tall afterwards. If you weighed X number of pounds before, you'd weigh that much afterwards. We're not talking about the physical part. And how many of you know that your mind didn't instantly become another mind? But we know that that spirit on the inside became brand new. It was the Word of God. Just as Mary conceived and brought forth Jesus, it's the same birthing process. The seed of the Word was planted in us. The Holy Ghost overshadowed it and caused it to come alive. And that which was birthed on the inside of us was a holy child of God. This brand new creation. If think about it a minute. In the beginning in Genesis, God created man. I mean, you know, man was a new creation. Now in this born again experience, we've become a new creation. A new creation. On the inside, you are totally brand new. And you are totally made in the image and likeness of God on the inside. And you're as holy as you'll ever get on the inside. You're as righteous as you'll ever get on the inside. You're as pure as you'll ever get on the inside. I mean, you know, that new person that we've become is the person we're going to be for all of eternity. Hallelujah. And yet, the majority of the church world hadn't grasped this, and they're still trying to work on the head and the physical actions, and they're hoping that if they can get the outside fixed up, maybe something will happen on the inside, and they'll be acceptable to God. That's called religion. Man's effort of trying to come into a relationship with God. But the only way you get in that relationship is God's way. And God's way is you must be born again. And as I said yesterday, I don't care who you are, where you're from, whether you like it or you don't like it. A birth process is something that you know happened. It doesn't sneak up on you. You don't grow into it. You don't perform any works to obtain it. You can't buy it. The only way you get it is what Paul wrote to the church at Ephesus and says, by grace are you saved through faith. And even that faith, not of yourselves, it's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. I'm telling you, it's God's grace that makes it possible for us to experience this new birth. And not only did he give us the grace to experience that, but gave us the faith to obtain the grace to experience it. What a deal. This is what Paul was writing in Thessalonians. Faithful is he who calls you, who also will do it. How many of you know you had nothing to do except respond to experience the new birth? I mean, I couldn't stand on my head in a corner for 3 hours and say, well, I'm going to get it this way. And folks, that's all. It's the inward change that has to take place, and it's the Spirit of God that causes that change. I mean, you know, the Holy Spirit was involved in the first act of creation. You know, the Holy Spirit's kind of the doer of the Trinity. Right now, he's the executor of the church. He's seeing that God's plan is being carried out in the world today. It's the Holy Spirit. And so the Spirit of God comes in and unites with your spirit and makes your spirit new. And you become a new person on the inside. Hallelujah. And it goes on, Paul wrote to the Corinthians, said, Jesus, who knew no sin, became sin for us in order that we might become the righteousness of God in him. We need to understand that all happened in the new birth process. Now, I mean, you know, there's still a couple of parts that need some work. Your head is the main part. The majority of our problem is right between our ears. And how many of you know that's where the battle is? That's where the battle is. But you know, a lot of people worry about their physical acts and really strive at trying to dictate to their flesh how to live. But you know, if you ever get your mind in agreement with your spirit, the old body just sets up and falls in line. Sometimes we just go at things the hard way and do them backwards. And you see a lot of churches trying to get everybody cleaned up on the outside, getting them ready. You know, how many times have you heard churches give altar calls? You know, just give up all your habits. You know, throw down all those bad things that you've been doing. Well, how many of you know? It's easier if you do it God's way, and he changes you on the inside, then all those other things begin to fall by the wayside. Because all of a sudden there's a new nature on the inside of you. And this new nature has only one desire, and that's to please God. And that new nature can't sin, won't sin, not even having a thought about sinning. The new part of us. So the first thing we need to see the Holy Spirit doing in us is producing an inward change. All right, number two. Jesus is once again teaching. Turn over to John chapter 4. Now it's amazing sometimes how we don't always see what's obvious. But the Gospel of John is the gospel that's written to believers. That's the reason that in John is all the instructions and information about the Spirit. Well, that's probably another course. I may come back and teach that. In a New Testament survey, you find out why there's four gospels. Where are we? John chapter 4? All right, for the sake of time, I'll give that assignment, read John chapter 4. And let me just paraphrase it. Some of you wake up about noon and say, oh, I get that, paraphrase, yeah. And John chapter 4 is the account given of Jesus meeting the lady at the well and the Samaritan lady. And in verse 10, we'll just go through and we'll lift a few thoughts out of here. Jesus says in verse 10, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given you living water. And then she came back and said, you don't have anything to draw with, and wells deep. How are you going to give me that? And are you greater than our father Jacob? And verse 13, Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. And then she said, give me the water. He dealt with her about her lifestyle. And then she begins to talk about where to worship. Verse 21, Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship you know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But now verse 23, but the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Now, the second thing that Jesus is ministering, and just to convey the thought, the second point that you probably need to take special note of that you might see at some time in the future is that the second change that's going to take place in you is going to be an upward worship. Number one, an inward change, but secondly, an upward worship. And this is covered here in John chapter 4, where Jesus is teaching this lady that if we're truly going to be worshipers of God, then we're going to have to worship him out of our spirit. And folks, once again, and we're not trying to, I hope you hear my heart, I'm not trying to be critical or judgmental or talk bad about people, but you know, we're in a Bible school setting. Some of the things that we say in Bible school would not be proper to say from a church pulpit, because you don't know who all is in a church service. But by you being in this place, you are saying to me, you've made a decision that you want to face up to what the situation is in the world and what we can do to change it. Amen. So when I'm talking about what's happening in the church, I'm not telling you to go back to your church and grab your pastor and say, you need to get this. I'm telling you, this is for our benefit, and God's going to send all of you out into whatever area he sends you, and it's your responsibility for your own life to begin to apply these truths, not to go correct everybody else. So when you hear me talking, I'm talking in a controlled classroom setting. And so to make a point, you have to say what's being done as opposed to what God would have be done. So hear my heart when I'm saying I'm not judging everybody. I'm not being critical of everybody. But the fact of the matter is, in most quote-unquote church services, there's not a lot of spirit-to-spirit worship going on. There's a lot of emotionalism. There's a lot of fleshly demonstrations, but very little spirit-to-spirit worship. And one of the reasons that is happening is we've never taken God seriously when he said, those who worship me must worship me in spirit, number one, but in truth. Now listen, and I hope you pay attention and begin to watch, and like I say, don't go correcting everybody. But so many of the churches that I've been privileged to attend and speak in over the years, during the song service, and that's what it is, I just stand there with my mouth closed. I'm not lifting my hands. I'm not involved, and people are looking at me thinking I'm not very spiritual. And I've had them come up to me and say, well, Brother Parr, I noticed you weren't entering into this. And I said, Let me ask you a question. Why were you watching me? I don't go to church to watch people. And so why are you watching what I do? See, that tells me immediately there's something wrong with the church service if I'm watching everybody else. Y'all can take this, can't you? You've already had a cup of coffee this morning. Hallelujah. And I'm sure Andrew's already had his Mountain Dew, so he's caffeined up also. It's okay. Ah, hallelujah. But people say, so why aren't you participating? I said, well, why are you lifting your hand? Well, it's a praise song. I said, it's a praise song? You're talking about what you're doing. All you've sung about so far is what you're doing. Now, where in that should a hand be lifted in praise to God when you're singing about yourself? Secondly, I'm not going to sing a song that's contrary to Scripture. I'm not going to sing about, God, don't take your spirit away from me. And I'm telling you, it's kind of quiet it down, praise God, but it wasn't that many years ago. Every church was singing, take not thy spirit from me. Create in me, Lord. Well, if you're born again, he already has. And he only does it once. You don't get born again, 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 and again. And I don't sing those songs, come Holy Spirit, we need you. Come Holy Spirit, I pray. Come Holy Spirit. And see, if you were listening to heaven, he'd be saying, already have, already have. I mean, you know, he came, he didn't leave. Jesus said when he came to abide forever. And so what am I talking about? I'm talking about worshiping God in spirit. We'll get to that in a minute. But the second part of that is truth. And if you're doing something contrary to the word of God, it's not truth. I don't care how many goosebumps you get. I don't care how many aisles you run. I don't care how many times you swing from the chandeliers or the fluorescent lights. I don't care how much you roll in the floor. If you're doing it and it's not in line with the word of God, it's not truth. I tell you what, you can watch some of this secular music and see people acting the same way they act in church. Oh, praise God. I'm gone tomorrow, so I can just... I'll let Andrew answer all these questions. But now, how in the world do we have a way that we can worship him in spirit? Well, I believe we do. Turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. And let's look at what verse I want to look at here for the sake of time. How about verse 15? 1 Corinthians 14, 15. Let's read verse 14. For if I pray in an unknown tongue, what part of you is praying?
Spirit.
Everybody say it out loud.
Spirit.
When you pray in an unknown tongue, your spirit is praying. But your understanding is unfruitful. What is it then? Well, I will pray with the spirit, and I will pray with the understanding also. Well, now let's read the next part. I will sing with the spirit. Now, do you think there's any connection with the verse before that? That if you're praying in tongues, it's your spirit praying. Well, if you're singing in the spirit, do you think it might be singing in tongues? Now, I'm not asking you to accept this just because I'm up here saying that. I'm asking you to meditate on that and ask God to show you if that's not the same thing. So if I'm going to worship God in spirit, and I'm told that if I'm praying in tongues, I'm praying in the spirit. If I'm singing in tongues, I'm singing in the spirit. Then it almost fits in line that if I'm worshiping in tongues, I'm worshiping in spirit. Now, let me just paint a scene some of you might not have ever experienced. But I started out in my walk with the Lord in a denominational church. And, you know, in that particular denomination, everything wasn't right, but everything wasn't wrong. They believed the Word of God, the part they wanted to believe. And they attempted to practice the part they believed. And there were times that they would really begin to bless God. You know, some of the old hymns are anointed by God regardless of who sings them, because they are directly to Him, adoring Him, magnifying His name. And so you'd be in some of these churches and you'd have these choirs would lift one of those grand old hymns to the throne of God, and you could feel the electricity in the place, and there's something on the inside of you was just, you know, but you didn't know what to do with it. And so they get through with this awesome song unto the Lord, and, you know, if you were real radical in that denomination, you might say amen. You hear what I'm saying? But most of the time it was just silence. Now, they've loosened up a little bit in the last few years. They now clap every once in a while. But I'm talking about back when I was a part of it, you'd have this wonderful hymn that's sung unto the Lord, and there's just something on the inside of you just wanting to do something, but you couldn't do anything. And like I say, sometimes you just get so full, you'd have to say, well, amen. And you'd have about 15 of them look at you. But what was happening? See, our spirit, if we were born again, was alive to God. And it was wanting to express. It was wanting to connect with God. But we didn't know how to release it. And I can remember, you know, as I continued to pursue the things of God and desiring all that God had for me. And I'm talking about I was a denominational pastor. But knowing that there was something, there was another realm that I wanted to move into. And some of those songs, I can remember at the time, Beverly Hills Baptist Church in Dallas was having an awesome thing happening over there. And so we drove a few miles up to Dallas, and we were in that service, and their choir sang I don't even remember what the song was. But I mean, it reached that point of highest, you know, rejoicing to the Lord. And when they finished the song, the whole congregation just burst into spontaneous praise. And man, they were shouting and they were praying in tongues and clapping. And I'm thinking, wow. There was a release that up until that point had been wanting to come out, but I didn't know how it was supposed to come out. And then a little while later, I received the baptism in the Holy Spirit. And was able to have a spiritual language. And then I found out that I could release all of that was on the inside of me unto the Lord by praying in tongues or singing in tongues, just worshiping God in tongues. And what a release came, because it was true upward worship unto God. I wasn't limited to saying hallelujah or glory to God. And I'm not opposed to all those things. But there was just a release that came as we began to magnify God in tongues. And you can read in the scriptures where they were filled with the Holy Ghost and magnified God in tongues. Because it's spirit to spirit that you begin to worship God in spirit. So the second change, the first one is an inward change, but then all of a sudden now you've got an upward worship that you can release unto God. We probably ought to do that about right now. Hallelujah. Oh, riamma tiki labo sumba riate ki hilabode. Yama mamago siki lanamok. Oh, lana de bahos. Come on, just go ahead and begin to bless the Lord. Go ahead, you can do it out loud. It's in order, you can do it out loud. Oh, nama rike le labo salam de hese lano. Oh, lana namaki te labo sumba riate ki hilabode. Yamariata kiri bosumbrata kiri osso barriande. Lurada tapekila loboso. O ramantigila bos. Diestara rabosusi. Oh, hallelujah. 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 Loriata kile monsumbrata ka. Mamriata kili lobosubri. Lamriata kiri bosubriata kile lomonte. Yamriata. Yes, to break the kilamonde esoborata kilo, la Maria teki, la Maria sula la rabahata. O la mamata kiriando. Yila la la masumiante. O rababane hilo la la masai. O la nanemia sula. Ila la rabasila namoto. Rola na mandia di rabasola Maria da che la la no masola la mande la mania suo la murata chi lo lo. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, we need to practice. Need to practice so it's not so difficult to let that happen. We ought to just be able to spontaneously, as we meditate on the fact that God is present. We're not believing for Him to show up. He's here. And we just want to have a communication, spirit to spirit, and worship Him in spirit and in truth. Sing in the Spirit. Sing in the Spirit. And see, I find out in a lot of charismatic, Pentecostal, full gospel, word of faith, spirit-filled, New Testament churches, whatever we are, they don't ever do it. It never happens. There's never an opportunity. There's never a place. We come out and we got 25 minutes of hit them with songs that we've got. Now, I'm not saying they're all bad, because how many of you know it says you can do that with an understanding. I mean, I believe you are to sing to the Lord. Now, you know, I'm not opposed to happy songs, happy clappy songs. There's a place for it. But, you know, there ought to be a time and a place that when believers come together, they just begin to sing unto the Lord in the Spirit. Now, that's your assignment the next 2 minutes. I want you to sing to the Lord in tongues. Go. Sing to the Lord a new song. Oh, Ricky Le Monde El Soboriata. Oh, Rabadakito of Sobala Narva. Lamo Brihete Kilamosala Nabahataya. Mamburiata carabasso briete che le monde esobo riete. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, every once in a while we need a little choir practice. Some of you, see, it's beginning, every time we do this, see, it's beginning to be more participation because you're getting out of that zone that you operated in that you can only do when, you know, when they get up and tell you now, everybody lift their hands and like look nice little puppets. We lift our hands and they say, now everybody say praise God, and everybody says praise God, and we just rehearse ourselves into, we go to church and follow the instructions. Almost like robots. We want to be told when to do everything that we do. There's no spontaneity. And God is saying, I want to raise up a people that will just worship me in spirit. Amen. Worship me in truth. And not have to be instructed to. Now, let's praise God. So everybody lift your hands. Are you hearing what I'm saying? And I'm not taking away from all we do. Bless God, there's some good songs out there. But they're not all worship songs. They're not all praise songs. And all I'm saying is, why don't we call them what they are? Now, there's a song I really like. And I'm not sure I even know the name of it, but it has the part in there, I can only imagine. And it's talking about when you get into the presence of God, are you going to stand? Are you going to be on your face? You know? Well, I love that song. I like the lyrics. I like the melody. I like everything about it. But, you know, I can't really say that's a praise song. Can't say that's really a worship song. Because it's talking about I'm imagining what it's going to be like for me. See, the song's all about me. So I'm not saying that's wrong. You can enjoy that, but don't stand up and say, now as I'm imagining what I'm going to do when I get to heaven. Are you hearing anything I'm saying? And what I'm trying to say, we need to get our spirit so activated and in charge that when I say, let's sing to the Lord a new song, you just cut loose. Let's sing to the Lord a new song. Well, about four of you got it. Hallelujah. Well, we'll continue this practice. You practice when you go home. You know a good place to practice? In the shower. I'm telling you, I've got an awesome voice in the shower. It's amazing how good I sound in there. I am impressed with me when I'm singing in the shower. Hallelujah. All right, number one, the Spirit's going to produce an inward change. Number two, an upward worship. And number three, John chapter 7, going to produce an outward flow. Those are three things that you probably need to remember. John chapter 7. Jesus is speaking, verse number 37. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Now, we've touched on this, but we need to understand that this outward flow begins with the baptism in the Holy Spirit. The outward flow begins with the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Now, when you're born again, the Spirit of God comes in you and is in you a well springing up into everlasting life. But when you receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit, that well becomes a river and it's flowing out of you to bring life to others. That's why we need the baptism in the Holy Spirit, not just so we can be more animated in our times of getting together, but it's so that we can become what he said we would become, witnesses. Now listen, the scripture didn't say, you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you and you'll go out and witness. Hello? And yet the church has grabbed it and In the denomination that I came out of and was a part of, we had Tuesday night visitation, and we went out to witness. And you know what we called witnessing? Getting somebody to confess they were sinners and say the sinner's prayer to get born again. And you know, those nights, as much as I love God, those were some of the most miserable nights I ever spent. I probably did as much praying on those nights as any other night, but my prayer would be, don't let them be at home. Let me just leave my little deal on their doorknob that I was here. I went with my pastor one time. He says, I'm going to help you. I'll make it easier for you. I'll show you how, when we get there, how you need to control the conversation and lead them into seeing where they are. So we walked in, sat down in this house, and he looked up and he said, man, that's a lovely painting you got there over your fireplace. By the way, have you ever accepted Jesus? Hallelujah. I'm telling you, it was tough to go out and do those things. But see, that's not what God anointed us to do. He anointed us to be. Yes. How many of you know there's a difference in being and doing? Yes. And I think we get into it in another lesson. How we see Scripture demonstrates how the early believers were witnesses. I mean, you know, you can be a witness more powerfully by the way you live than by what you say. And one reason the church is not a more effective witness is because we say one thing and we do another. I'm being real nice. I'm not as, well, no, I'll just be like Jesus. The problem is we're a bunch of hypocrites. Hallelujah. You probably ought to sing again, huh? But do you realize that's why we're here? See, if all that a relationship with God was about was to get to heaven when we died, the kindest thing God could have done the minute we were born again hit us in the head. If that's what it was all about, just as when you're born again, shoot them. But see, we're here for a reason. And that reason is because we are now the Word being made flesh on the earth so that people can see God. We're it. He doesn't have another plan. We're it. And as we look at each other, we know God's a faith God. Well, look around. He chose us. Hallelujah. But what we're learning to do is cooperate with the Spirit of God, and He's the one that gives us the ability to do everything that God has asked us to do. And I tell you what, when you learn that and just learn to cooperate and get involved in that outward flow, it becomes fun to do what God asks you to do. It's not work. It's not labor. It's fun. I've been doing it for 31 years, and I still enjoy every minute of it. Hallelujah. It's as much fun now as it was when it's maybe more, because the more you know and the more you learn to cooperate with God, the more enjoyable it becomes. And how many of you know that should be the prayer of every believer, that Paul's prayer was that I finish my course in joy. It's not a burden. It's not hard. It's not difficult. Man, if you're fighting and struggling with something, it's probably not God. Because His yoke is easy. His burden is light. Hallelujah. Well, that's that lesson. We'll close right there.